My sermon today is boldly written in the word, which is the complete man, sound, successful, and what? Satisfied. I know many people who have met me in church, I didn't know my father. I know people who were born out of rape. I know people whose fathers have never done anything good for them in life. I know people whose father have abused them all through life. But when the Bible uses the word father, he recognizes that there are various kinds of people who pose as fathers but don't have the father's spirit. But when he uses the word father, he's really referring to the fatherhood of God, which is shown in the way we relate to people. I don't play with fathers, because whosoever plays with his father doesn't advance. And whosoever blesses his father advances. We also know that in this church, we all have different levels of growth. And our Father's Day in this church is to honor the men, because men has the womb of fatherhood, not necessarily those who have children. And so Father's Day is to honor all married men. And that's why I'm inviting all married men to my house at 4 o'clock. Not just to eat a sumptuous dinner. I'm not planning with somebody, but the time for us to talk to one another. Your challenges. And I pray God helps you. I read from the book of Psalm 8, verse 5. Now, before that, Psalm 8, he started, "The worst man that thou art mindful of, or the son of man that thou visited him. For thou art made him a little lower than the angels, or lower than God. For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels, and hast crowned him with glory and honor." The Voice Bible, which is my most favorite Bible, says, "But you placed the Son of Man just beneath God and honored him with royalty, crowning him with glory and honor." That is God's plan for man. Ecclesiastes 7, chapter 26 to 29, I read. "One discovery, a woman can be a bitter pill to swallow." I don't feel there's any woman who is like that here. "Full of seduction and charming and grasping. The lucky escape her. The undiscerning get caught. At least, this is my experience. What I, the quester, have pierced together as I have tried to make sense of life. But the wisdom I have looked for, I haven't found. I don't find one man or woman in a thousand worth my while. Yet I did spot one ray of light in the mark. God made men and women true and right. We read the ones who made the mess of our life." Along the journey, the voice said, "I discovered something more bitter than death." Well, let me go to verse 7. Look at this. "After investigating the matter thoroughly to find out why things are as they are, I realized that although I kept searching, I have not found what I'm looking for. Only a man in a thousand have I found, but I could not find a woman, a single man. Here is what I have figured out. God made humanity for good, but we humans go out and scheme our way into trouble." Now, this scripture says that "I looked for many, I did not find one man." He mentioned 1,000 women because the man had 1,000 women at his display. And among the 1,000 women, he said he didn't see one good woman. Unfortunate. I know if some of you had married to him, you would have seen him, he would have spotted you. But he now looked among 1,000 men. He found only one man. And today I want our men to strive to be the complete man that is sound, successful, and satisfied. Somebody met me and said, "I want to be like that great newscaster." I wouldn't mention his name. He's won many awards. But I told them that that man has been 9 times married. 9 times married. Divorced 9 times. Another one met me and said, "Look, I want to be that great general." And later we heard that that man was a pedophile, having a relationship with children. Another person said, "I want to be like that great business tycoon." And then we learned the man was using dope in secret, hemp. Then somebody said, I want to be like that great general, that great man. But that man doesn't know his wife and children. Today we read in the paper that it's a general overseer who for 30 years had never known his children or the wife. I don't know how true that is. And so you have people who are great in this, but not so great in that. People are wonderful in this, but not so wonderful in that. The great man of God, John, saw a city. And in that city, saw that the height, the length, and the breadth of that city was balanced. And Paul said that your body, soul, and spirit might be preserved, what? Blameless. Paul said that God is going to complete that which is lacking in you. God is a God of completion. He doesn't believe in. Peter says, if these things abound in you, you shall not be unfruitful. And so if they don't abound, you are unfruitful. If you are a great tycoon, but a poor father, you are not complete. If you are a great, intelligent person, and you are not spiritual, you are not complete. Some people are intellectual giants, but spiritual dwarfs. Many are money rich, but they are morally poor. And I want to tell you in a very simple thing, and I'm going to fast forward this sermon a little bit, to say there are a few things I think that will make a man complete. Number one is the word authenticity. Looks like a big word. What does authenticity mean? If you are going to be complete, you must be authentic. The word authentic means you must be real. You must be real. You must be as you are. You must not have two kinds of life. A private life, a public life. A secret life, an open life. Webster defined reality as actual being of or existence of anything, truth, fact, in distinction from mere appearance, actual being of certain things. No one can be a complete person who acts as an actor. The word hypocrite is a person who is acting a part that he is not. And men are very good at being hypocritical. I know of men who have 3 cell phones. One for their girlfriend, one for their wife, and one for their mistress. That's not being authentic. You have to be real. And real simply means no double life. You see, there are 4 ways people can look at you. Who you are, really, that's your real. Who you are supposed to be, that's your aspiration. Who people think you are, that's your reputation. What you are becoming, that is your prayer. Who you are is your authentic person. Who you are supposed to be, that's your aspiration. Who people think you are, that's your reputation. Reputation is not synonymous with character. You may have a good reputation, but a bad character. Reputation is the external things. Character is your individuality. And every time we find this tension between what is real and what is the image, between what actually we are and what we orchestrate people to think we are, you can't be complete until you are authentic. I travel a lot. I go to many places. And I don't have any problem because I tell myself that it's self-deceit to think I'll be doing something and the world will not know. As long as you are doing something with somebody, somewhere, it's already open secret. There's nobody that can keep your secret when his life is in danger. And nobody that can keep your secret when he is revealing your secret, you make him better. There are no friends when it comes to protecting self. So be authentic. Be authentic. The second thing I want to say that if you are going to be a complete man, please have deep affection for your wife. 90% of men I meet talk evil of their wives. When you go among the meetings, among men, men will tell you a lot of things about their wife. I was in the plane some time ago, and I looked at two men, and they appeared to be ministers. And all they were talking about how their wives are so difficult. Then the man was saying, just keep enduring. He said, I bought her a car, she's not satisfied. I gave her this, she's not satisfied. I did that for that, she's not satisfied. Most men carry a grief in their heart and ask themselves, how I wish the clock could reverse. And I will say no. Some women are so domineering of their husband that their husband becomes like pupils. And so at home, they are very sedate. But when you go out, they talk loud and you wonder whether they are the same kind of persons. The truth about it is that the problem is common with all men. And if a thing is common with all men, then it is common with everybody. And so the problem is not those people. It is how you handle it. And I want to give a very simple formula. A formula that I practice, I'm not perfected, but a formula that I strongly believe. Study your wife's moods. So women's moods are like caterpillars. Some of them are like roller coaster. They are up here, they are down here. They are very excited and happy tomorrow, they are very depressed. They laugh and very joyful, and they begin to cry. Sometimes you wonder why they are crying. Explain your cry. You can't explain. I gave you a story that happened in the UK. A man was looking for a place to park. The wife was waiting. 20 minutes, the woman has not come. 25 minutes, the man has not come. The woman started crying. Hey, my husband has deserted me. Hey, my husband has deserted me. 35 minutes later, the man came. Said, darling, I thought you deserted me. But it's no surprise, it happens. While we were in UK, listen, a lady told me that she was going to the market, going to the supermarket, and he was carrying two children, two beautiful children, and as they were going to the market, he looked around and he saw her husband with another lady in the street, romantically with a woman, kissing and hugging and everything. So he just quickly hid the young children from seeing the father and ran to the supermarket. By the time he came back home, the husband has packed a few of his things and wrote there, I'm leaving you. But that's not Bible. The Bible says, husband, you must, is the word, love your wives so deeply, purely, and sacrificially. That's Ephesians 5:25. That we can understand it only when we compare it to the love of God. The anointed one laid his pride, his life for the church. We know it because he gave himself completely to her. And that is the kind of love God expects you to have. When the Bible says you should love your wife, he's not saying love her because she's good. He doesn't say love her because she's nice. He doesn't say love her because she's lovely. He says love her because the anointed one, Jesus, loved you and gave himself for you. And the Bible says no one really hates his body. But we cherish it, we take care of it, and just as we take care of our body, so God wants us to take care of our wife. And so I want to say that, please, for your goodness sake, love your wife. The reason is that it will give you peace. It will protect you. It will allow you to concentrate. It will preserve you. If you don't do it, you're going to have problems. You're going to have difficulty. Another woman is never a solution. Never a solution. It has its own honeymoon. But when it is finished, the other woman will be worse than the first. And so, stay with the one you have married and love her. Love is a verb. Love is an act. Love is intentional. Love is not circumstantial. Love is not because of, it's in spite of. Love is a command. And I want to say this clearly, because I'm not going to spend too long on this topic. There are a few things, I know there are challenges of women. I was reading an ancient script, and I won't quote that ancient script, who says, there are no good women on earth. But the man who wrote it is a man. And if a woman has written it, would have said, there's no good man in the earth. So please, be tolerant to your wife. Be tactful in dealing with her. Be tender. Be thoughtful. Go through with her. And sometimes, be ready to touch her and be teachable. Your wife can teach you a lot of things. Your wife can bless you in a lot of ways. You do it, you will have rest. You do it, you'll be able to be filled with blessing. And I want to tell you very clearly, when you love your wife as unto God, God is going to give you the blessing of obedience. God is going to give you the blessing of obedience. He's going to give you the blessings of obedience. If every man complains of their wife, then it's a common problem. It's a common problem with womanhood. Why not be different? Why not see the sunshine rather than the darkness? Why not see the stars rather than the darkness? Why not see the good side rather than the bad side? Why not see the cup half full rather than half empty? Why not celebrate the good things in her rather than the evil things in her? Why not celebrate her best times rather than her bad times? Why not thank God for her rather than blame God for her? What you get to do in every time, you get conversant with it, you get perfected in it. And when you get conversant to say you love your wife, you care for your wife, you think about her, before you know, you will be able to win that normal human desire not to love the husband, not to love your wife. Let me say this. Let not your mother tell you how to love your wife or tell you against your wife or your father or your brothers or your sisters. They have lived their life. Live your life. Live your life. People are self-centered. They don't look at you in terms of your relationship. And life goes through phases. There's a time you cannot even give anything to your parents because you have not made it. There are times you cannot even give anything to your brothers. But if you cultivate togetherness, one day you'll be able to do things forever. Don't let people push you to fight one another. In loving your wife, I want to say, take time to manage your anger. Keep it under control. Somebody said the word anger is one word short of danger. And the philosophers tell us that when a man is angry, he's wise no more. When you are angry and you keep it, you internalize it, it causes depression, ulcers, and pain. When you are angry and you externalize it, it destroys your environment and contaminates relationship. And so the best policy is be slow to speak, slow to wrath, quick to hear. Do not try to allow, watch out for those emotional triggers that generate anger in you. Watch out for them. And say to yourself, peace, be still. You can only do that if you keep your anger under control. Be quick to say sorry. I met a man from Saudi Arabia. And he came late for work, as I told him. I said, you are late today. Do you have any problem with your wife? I said, no, I never quarrel with my wife. My wife is always right. And when my wife said I'm wrong, I said, sorry. And there's peace. Sorry is a very great thing to say. I am sorry, dear. I'm sorry, darling. Be quick to say sorry. You see, no matter how hard a problem is, when you are soft on a person, the person will break. The Bible says a soft answer word driveth away wrath. It's only fools that get angry. Please, don't get angry. Resist reactive behavior. There's something I always write. I say there are three things that define life. The event, the outcome, and the reaction. But what many people do is that they move from the event to reaction, then to outcome. But that's not the best way to solve life work. You solve life problem by the event, the outcome, then the reaction. That if you have an event in your life, look at that event and visualize the outcome. Then let the outcome advise you on your reaction. And if that's going to happen, you must know the power of 3 minutes pause. You are stupid, you are foolish, you are mad. You are a man who doesn't take care of me. This. You have done, look. A woman's logic is a woman's emotions. Doesn't mean anything. Sometimes she didn't remember what she said. So just give her the 3 minutes pause. Be quiet. Incredible pause. And then rather than defend, I did this, said, I am sorry, dear. Because she's always right. Almost always right. Proverbs 16:32 says, whosoever is slow to anger is better than the mighty, and he who rules his spirit than he that takes a city. Soft answer drives away wrath. Separate facts, feeling, and judgment. Proverbs 17:1 says, better is a dry morsel with quiet than a house full of feasting with strife. Outgrow your anger. Anger is very infantile. Anger is very pediatric. Anger is a sign that you haven't really matured. Anger is childish. That is the way children react. Matured men control their anger. So outgrow your anger. Anger is rooted in pride, my pride. And pride, as I told you, is the siren that tells people you are going to fall. Help your wife's mood. Use common sense. Use tact. Use tenderness. But for goodness sake, don't use tantrums. I know sometimes it's very difficult for some of us to control our anger. Some of us are genetically angry. And we come from families that anger seems to be the pattern. Our gene reads anger. But let me tell you, the Bible says the wrath of man does not what? Produce the righteousness of God. So anger is what? Counterproductive. When something is not benefiting you, what do you do? What do you do? Tell somebody, let it go. When something is not profiting you, let it go. Let it go. Make sure, because anger is unproductive. It is unattractive. It's usually unforgettable. It is unnecessary. And many times, it's unpardonable. So if you don't need it, let it go. So I say, what has annoyed me? Pause. Follow your knees and say, God, give me grace to survive. Some of us, we are always doing internal dialogue, going over the rehearsals of what your wife or your husband or your brothers did. As long as you have internal dialogue, you always have external misery. When you are having internal dialogue, telling what people have not done bad to you, say, peace be still. You also have wrong people. Moreover, you wrong Jesus. And he says, Father, what? Forgive them. Please fight against your anger before your anger fights against you. You see, let your heart be like plasticine so that God can easily mold it. I wrote, you know, I went in my meditation this last week. I wrote there, Gregory, I decide, I make a principle that I'll be too hard for anybody to annoy me. It will be too hard for everybody to make me abuse him. It will be too hard for anybody to make me not to love him. I will make my heart like plasticine. No matter what you do to me, I will make it too hard for you to get me annoyed. Too hard for you to make me not to forgive you. The heart of man is so fragile. The heart of women is even more fragile. Just make a comment and tell a woman that your hair doesn't look so good early in the morning. Watch out throughout the day. Watch out throughout the day. In those days when my mother would prepare food, I say, well, not so bad. It is good. Don't say not so bad. Their hearts are so easily bruised. So with all human beings. So it's all human beings. You say your glasses look like Professor Mantos. You see, you go to the mirror and look at it. Am I Professor Mantos? You must titrate your words to suit your audience. And you must titrate your statement to suit your wife. If you know your wife is the type of person who is so sensitive to words, sugarcoat it. Because the Bible says, let your word be what? Seasoned with salt. At home, diplomacy is possible. And politics is good as long as it's not dubious. Sometimes you need to be very tender. Sometimes you need to tell her, praise her to high heavens. Even if you are doing it by faith, God will make it happen. Well, we move on further. I don't think I'll go spend more time on that. The third thing I want to say that Stay accountable. If you're going to be a great man in this life, and you're going to be a complete man, you must be accountable. I fear for any man on this earth who no one can tell him, don't do this. That stupid arrogance is what destroys most men. Men are very proud. I don't take counsel for anybody. I don't take anybody's opinion. If you have a husband, you are a wife, who has no mentor, who has no pastor, who has nobody that can stop him, beg your husband, kneel down and beg your husband at home. Husband, you are on a very wrong path. Because every man is half wise, a quarter wise, a third wise. It is when we are in a community, we are complete. And so if you are going to stay wise, you must be accountable for someone. Not being accountable is suicidal, is insane, is delusional.